morning, everybody. I'm John Hughes. I'm the president of the National Press Club, and I want to welcome you here to today's event. Press freedom is such a big deal for us at the Press Club. It is every year, but especially this year, we've made it such a huge priority. I'm wearing my Free Jason pin. You might have seen our Jason resigns stand out in the lobby. Last week, we had a large event with protecting freelancers in war zones. So this is just a huge issue. And what can be a better way to get into this issue than what we're doing here today? The protection of whistleblowers is hugely important. All of us who are reporters have used whistleblowers over the years. And if we didn't have whistleblowers coming forward, we would be in great trouble trying to do our jobs as reporters. So I'm going to get this event underway by calling up Norman Sullivan. Norman. He's the executive director of the Institute for Public Accuracy. Come on up. Thank you.
Thanks, John, and I'd like to welcome everybody here today. All seven speakers who you're going to hear from are on the advisory board of Exposed Facts, which opened last summer at exposedfacts.org. It's a project of the Institute for Public Accuracy. The communications director of IPA, Sam Husseini, is here, and we've been in the building, about 17 years here now. In the interest of time, I won't repeat the full bios. You have some detailed information on the handout sheet that you got on the way in. And so I'll be very brief so that we can get on to hear the speakers. Reminder to make sure that your cell phone is securely off. Exposed Facts is dedicated to supporting whistleblowers, whistleblowing, and independent journalism. And it's in that context that we've pulled together this news conference today. You're going to hear from the speakers for about 5 minutes each in alphabetical order, their last name. In other words, same order as on the bio sheets. And then we're going to have time for Q&A. The first speaker we're going to hear from is William Binney. He's a former high-level National Security Agency intelligence official who, after his retirement in 2001, after 30 years at the agency, blew the whistle on NSA surveillance programs. And I want to mention to you that if you have not seen it yet, and even if you have, it's worth going back and looking again at the mini documentary that Laura Poitras did about William Binney, which was posted on the New York Times website at opdocs at nytimes.com 10 months before Edward Snowden first went public. And you'll see how much William Binney shared with the public at that time in the late summer of 2002. So with that, William Binney.
Thanks. Can I get that?
Chair.
It was that interview with you that led Ed Snowden to Laura
Poitras
to talk to her.
Yes, it was. Yeah, and since I helped design internally in NSA the programs that they're using to spy on everybody in the United States and the world, I felt a little responsible for what was happening, so I thought that I should at least address this to the government, the U.S. government, to say they're violating the constitutional rights of everybody in the country. And what they did originally was keep it all in as a covert program. That meant they could limit who knew about it in Congress, and also they limited the number of people in the judiciary that knew about it, too. That's how they tried to terrorize everybody and fearmonger about terrorism and the next attack is just around the corner and things like that. And that's how they manipulated people and coerced them into agreeing to it. And once they were agreed to it, they were co-opted in. And they were doing this with the leadership of Congress and with the senior judge starting in January of 2002 with the senior judge at the FISA court. So once they got them co-opted in, they had a defense in all branches of government. So, and they kept it all secret and lied about it publicly. So they kept the entire electorate uninformed, and they kept most of Congress uninformed. So that meant they were lying to everybody. And that's still going on today. I mean, they were talking about it. Hayden keeps saying things like, well, this is not about content. We never collected content. Well, that was a lie from the beginning. I mean, that's why Thomas Tam told the New York Times what he did, and he was the source of the New York Times article, because he was seeing all the source information coming from content, translation of phone calls and things like that, in requests coming from the FBI to go to the FISA court. Well, they weren't supposed to have that data until they went to the FISA court to get a warrant in the first place. So it was obviously illegal wiretaps. So those things were going on all the way from 2001 up. It was content and metadata. I mean, that's why they had to build Bluffdale, because they need, with metadata, the storage required to store all of that for everybody in the world for 50 to 100 years in every domain of communications and transactions between people would take something like a room of the size of 20 by 40 foot. The rest of that was for content. And they'd been lying to us and duping us and actually manipulating everybody in the country to go along with this all along. And so, I mean, even in spite of the fact that I've been talking about it, well, I had no credibility because I was a disgruntled employee. This is the character assassination, you know, they go through. In the case of Russ Tice, he was mentally disturbed, you know. Or in other cases, you know, they were criminals or something like that. So they try to change the narrative to keep it away from the secret unconstitutional activity they've been saying. I mean, they try to say it's legal, but they never tell you it's constitutional, because they don't allow and won't allow, as best they can, they're trying to keep it out of the Supreme Court, any constitutional challenge to this process that they're going through, which is spying on the U.S. people. I mean, that's the violation of the Constitution that I've been objecting to. And so, as far as I'm concerned, you, the people of the United States, and even the Congress of the United States would never know about this without whistleblowers. If you didn't have a whistleblower telling you this, like me or Kirk or others, you would never know. And that's the way the government really wanted to keep it. They wanted to keep it silent, to keep you, so they could manipulate and control the population of the country as well as the Congress. So this is not an informed electorate, and this is not a democracy. We're being manipulated. Thank you.
Thank you, Bill. And let me give the exact date of the Historic Now documentary I mentioned. It was posted on the New York Times op-doc site August 23rd, 2012. That's August 23rd, the year 2012. And it was called The Program, explosive, especially in retrospect, documentary about the work and the outspoken whistleblowing of our first speaker, who we just heard, William Binney. We're now going to hear Thomas Drake. Thomas Drake is a former senior executive at the National Security Agency, where he blew the whistle on massive multi-billion dollar fraud, waste, and widespread violations of the rights of citizens through secret programs for surveillance after 9/11. Thomas Drake.
You know, in a societal panopticon, the goal is to eliminate all privacy. On my lapel, I wear a Q. I've been wearing it for a number of years now. I first started wearing it during the months right prior to when I was scheduled to go to a public trial after the government indicted me on 10 felony counts, including 5 under the Espionage Act, for committing the truth. This Q stands for question everything, especially authority. And especially when that authority is abused. You see in front of you a number of whistleblowers, going all the way back to the Vietnam era with Daniel Ellsberg, and all the way forward to the post 9/11 national security state. We're the canaries in the constitutional coal mine. we're the ones that are speaking truth to enough power, and they don't like it. You see, the government is in the unamendment business. The Constitution stands in the way of their objectives, the secret side of government. And after 9/11, when I was confronted with the stark reality that we had opened up Pandora's box, the phrase that I continue to hear, which you don't understand, Mr. Drake, we live in exigent conditions. Emergency means and measures are necessary. Government had failed to protect the nation. Almost 3,000 people were murdered, including hundreds of foreign nationals. And so the government chose in the deep secrecy to unchain itself from the Constitution. And what I was confronted by was not just the wheels had come off our constitutional republic, but the government was now in an entirely different vehicle, a vehicle I did not recognize, an alien form of government, a form of government to which I had taken an oath not to defend. My oath is to support and defend a constitutional government. And so the government licensed unto itself in secret an extraordinary series of surveillance programs, literally granting NSA the power to turn itself on ourselves. And in doing so, as this rapidly metastasized over the intervening years, it militarized this space. And just parenthetically insert here, people forget that NSA was never brought into existence by legislation. It was literally created with a stroke of a secret presidential pen in 1952, a military intelligence agency, militarizing the space we live in. What was the legal basis for this extraordinary mass surveillance program at NSA, known as Stellar Wind, at the White House, known as the President's Surveillance Program, otherwise known as the program? Something I heard and learned about and found out about within days after 9/11. The legal basis, for those who recall a recent debate between General Michael V. Hayden, retired, former CIA and NSA director, and Judge Napolitano at CPAC, that the legal basis for this program, quote, unquote, raw executive authority. But hey, catch 22, Joseph Heller, we have the power now. Who's going to stop us? I would refer you to a book written by Andrew Wallace Hadrill, The Imperial Court in the Augustine Empire. Quote, moreover, under the empire, the secrets of power, the arcana imperii, were to be untrammeled by rules, and that the law of silence prohibited any public discussion of matters of state. You see, I'm the only person in relationship to the surveillance programs, the mass surveillance programs. Petri dish was the United States and exported on an extraordinary scale overseas, including entire countries, targeting everything. The mantra was to collect it all. But see, I'm the only person in relationship to those mass surveillance programs that was criminally investigated, secretly charged, prosecuted, indicted, convicted, and sentenced. None of the people who authorized the programs, up to and including President Bush on 4 October 2001, we still haven't seen that memo, none of the people implemented the programs, nor was Director Hayden or anybody else held accountable. The only persons were held accountable were those who dared hold up the mirror regarding the unconstitutionality of the mass surveillance programs as it was unleashed in the deepest of secrecy. All I know in terms of the oath I took four times to support and defend is that the first three words of the extraordinary preamble of the Constitution say, we the people. It doesn't say we the secret state, it doesn't say we NSA, it doesn't say we the president. It says we the people in order to form a more perfect union. But to be truly sovereign, people need information. And what the government is in the business now is controlling the information regarding its own activities, because controlling it is power. And if you have secret power, you want to hold on to that power so no one dare expose you. And if so, we will criminalize you even when you expose government criminal conduct and activities. And so in summary, where I'm throwing my weight right now, recognizing that one avenue is the legislative avenue, that extraordinary branch that's supposed to work in the Constitution, in which legislation actually turns into law. And so I'm throwing my weight behind H.R. 1466, the Surveillance State Repeal Act. I look forward to your questions.
Our next speaker is Daniel Ellsberg, a former U.S. military analyst who served in Vietnam, worked for the RAND Corporation, and then risked many decades in prison with release of the top secret Pentagon papers to the New York Times and many other newspapers in 1971, has been tireless ever since, speaking out for a whole range of causes. Daniel Ellsberg.
I'm really happy to have this opportunity today, actually, for two reasons. First, that I'm accompanied here by some of my very closest friends in the world that I identify with more than anyone else as sources and whistleblowers. I'd say more than anyone else except Chelsea Manning and Ed Snowden. And seriously, that's there's also Glenn Greenwald and Laura Poitras, who, like Snowden, are with me on the Freedom of the Press Foundation, but they are journalists. I like Julian Assange, also a hero of mine. I'm not a journalist. I'm a source, like the people here. And I'm a whistleblower, and like I think virtually everyone here, someone who went through a trajectory of working for the government as a patriot, working for the president, and still feeling as patriotic as before, but having learned other ways to serve my country than to work for the president and keep my mouth shut about the president's secrets, no matter what they are, how criminal, how embarrassing to the party, to the agency, to the administration. For years, I observed that ethic, my promise to keep secrets, especially those that would embarrass my teammates and my agency, above any other obligation. That was the ethic that I shared with all my colleagues, and I suspect will be familiar to the other people at this table. And I finally learned that wasn't, after all, the best way to serve my country, that the oath that we all took was not an oath of office. The oath that we all took was not an oath to the president or to secrecy. Actually, we signed secrecy agreements many times as conditions of employment. We also took an oath, and that was to support and defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic. And I have come to believe, by the way, that certain officials, like Vice President Dick Cheney, were domestic enemies of the Constitution in the sense of that oath. Not that he's not patriotic. I'm not saying he's a traitor. I know that he wants the best for his country, but he believes that the best for his country was not the Constitution as written, but the new one of essentially monarchical powers that was necessary after 9/11. And actually, Cheney thought that well before. He thought it at the time of the Pentagon Papers, that Richard Nixon should not have faced impeachment for the crimes he did against me, most of which have now been legalized, though not constitutionalized. You can't really rescind the Fourth Amendment, First Amendment, by a majority vote in Congress, but we're acting as though, Congress is acting as though that has been done with the mass surveillance, particularly. Now, when I say I'm also happy to address this audience of journalists, I feel a kind of affinity which isn't usually, I've come to learn, reciprocal, reciprocated. It took me a while to discover that, really. I sort of thought, as a source, I was in some sense on the same team as the investigative journalists. After all, I do regard investigative journalists in the absolute highest respect as being essential to democracy and to republic. And it seems kind of self-evident that without sources, no investigative journalism. And we're talking about the area of national security here. So that really means people who give unauthorized disclosures of classified information, since nearly all of it's of any worth at all or any possible worthy of investigation is classified. So it means turning it over. A question I'd like to have a discussion later is, I've often wondered and rarely asked journalists, do they or do they not regard the people who are giving them classified information as criminals? All of them. We see every day, we're giving anonymity, which is necessary to get the source, because this person is not authorized to discuss this or not, or it's classified. My impression is that most journalists believe that a clear-cut constitutional law is being violated when they're being given that information. And really, I have for a long time, I have to say, and we can talk about this, believed, and it's not that I've suffered from this particularly, but I see other people, believe that many journalists regard their sources of national security information the way police regard their informants, their criminal informants. Necessary, important, necessary to their career, necessary to the public. But snitches, bad guys, not to be respected, truthfully, protected in their identity, like their informant, but lawbreakers. Now, when I say that, I think from my point of view as the first person ever prosecuted for leaking information in this country, the first person, two after me, sent before Obama, the two cases, and 10 under Obama. But I was the first, and so I've kept up with the history of that. It's my impression that most journalists, and by that I mean nearly all journalists, really don't have a knowledge of the legislative history and the background of the Espionage Act that's used in these cases, or the general, quote, law of whistleblowing or leaking. I really, if there are exceptions here, that may well be. More power to you, and I'd like to meet the persons who are the exceptions. My guess is that whatever yours, and I'm not trying to insult anybody here, be condescending, unless you've been tried on this or pressed like a James Risen in court, I'm sure he knows the story very well, you really are not likely to know much about it. And I just think you should consider that possibility that there's more to know. And I'd love to discuss it here or later. As I said, I'm not a journalist, I'm a source. But I was, my only connection with journalism, I was on the Harvard Crimson. And in fact, although in 40 years since the Pentagon Papers, I've never been invited by Harvard to give a lecture back, but I was delighted just 2 days ago, somebody sent me at Harvard a poster that was all over the Harvard yard, they said, with my picture on it. It was a Harvard Crimson Comp, the competition. And they said, before Daniel Ellsberg gave the Pentagon Papers, he comped for the Harvard Crimson. This was a recruiting poster. I loved it, and I've asked them to send me. There were some other people, but I was one of those. So at a Crimson dinner, it occurred to me, looking at you, an annual dinner many years ago, about 20 years ago, I said as follows, half jokingly, and really when I thought about it, it was less jokingly. I said, I think there should be a Pulitzer Prize for sources. Now, of course, the sources are anonymous, and they have to be, so the reporter would have to be, receive it for themselves. It probably shouldn't have money, so not to look as if you're paying for information here, but they should be recognized as part of the process that the First Amendment requires. And I said, not to be seem self-serving here, I would not suggest it be retroactive, this Pulitzer Prize, though I would not mind if it took the form of an idealized statuette to be called the Danny. And in fact, I said, ideally, it would be given where the Oscars used to be given, the Santa Monica Civic Auditorium, which was across the street from the Rand Corporation. Well, anyway, I think there's something to this. I think the Reidenauer Prizes, where some of us will be going on Wednesday, are one of the first things that come along that really do encourage whistleblowers. They even have money associated with them, which is very nice. I've gotten a lot of awards that consist of pieces of paper without Jefferson or Washington on the cover. And it's very nice to get that. But above all, it legitimizes the idea that the source has done what they should have done, was a good thing to do. And we can't have too much of that because, in my opinion, we need more Snowdens. We need more Chelsea Mannings. Had there been someone like Snowden or Chelsea Manning with their sense of conscience and oath to the Constitution before the Iraq War in the lead up to it, there would not have been an Iraq War. And that would have been a very great service to this country and the world and to the Middle East and elsewhere. I think the lies that led us into that war could have been exposed. I regret that I kept my mouth shut as we were being lied into the Vietnam War for years, and very much regret that I didn't put out the information that I later did put out before the bombs had started falling. So that's why I'm here. Thank you.
Our next speaker is Ray McGovern, former CIA analyst who chaired the National Intelligence Estimates in the 1980s. And he prepared the daily briefs for presidents from John F. Kennedy to George H.W. Bush. So now, Ray McGovern.
Thank you, Norm. And thanks to all my colleagues. I don't have to read the Fourth Amendment as I usually do at the beginning of all my remarks. I would add that in the debate that Tom referred to, General Hayden added that, look, I didn't have to ask Mother May I. I had the authority to do what I did. Gross violation of the Fourth Amendment. That was the same debate, was it not, Tom? Well, I'm not going to take a lot of time now. I want to focus on the seminal event of this century, which you all know is 9/11. We had the information that should have prevented 9/11. Now, we all know how the CIA screwed up, intentionally or not, by not sharing the information on those two characters in San Diego. We all know how the FBI screwed up by not allowing Colleen Rowley and her associates to pursue Mousawi. But no one knows that NSA had all the information necessary on that terrorist site in Yemen, including the telephone number, not only of that site, but of the two hijackers in San Diego. How do I know that? These people here can attest to it, especially Tom, who looked into it at the direction of the NSA authorities, who told him, Tom, I really wish you hadn't told us that, and he was suppressed. What I'm saying here is very, very serious. Michael Hayden, the head of NSA, suppressed the information that would have certainly, or almost certainly, led to the prevention of 9/11. Now, why is that important? Well, it's important because there were no whistleblowers around at the time. Now, Colleen Rowley and Bogdan Zakovic, a name you probably don't recognize, but who headed up the red team for the FAA, okay, found out before 9/11 that he could penetrate not only airfields but airplanes 9 out of 10 times with his red team. All that would have been necessary is to put locks on the doors of the cockpit, okay, and they didn't do it. Did Zakovic get a hearing? No, he didn't. He was suppressed. Now, again, whether it was misfeasance or malfeasance, the historians will have to decide, but he was suppressed. Colleen Rowley and Bogdan wrote an article. It's in the LA Times. Look it up. The title is What If? What if there were WikiLeaks? What if there were The Intercept? What if there were honest people really interested in getting at the truth to warn the American people about the dangers? What if? Well, you see here people who tried to do it and could not do it because of the lack of a way to get the news out. Why is Eric Holder and our president being so tough on whistleblowers? Why is James Risen the bête noir? They couldn't get Risen, but they were reasonably sure they could get Jeffrey Sterling on the vaguest of circumstantial evidence. Were there telephone calls between Jeffrey Sterling and James Risen? Yes, there were. Ha ha. Was this Project Merlin mentioned in any of those telephone calls? Well, no, but there were a lot of calls. You have the hanging of a person against whom the case was not proven. So What does this all mean to me? I guess it means to me that this is replete with miscarriages of justice. The most recent one, the one that I sat in court watching, the miscarriage of justice against Jeffrey Sterling, who the Justice Department wanted to make an example of. Lesson, do not, whatever you do, speak to journalists. Do not, whatever you do, especially not speak to James Risen. It's clear as a bell. The final indignity has to do with the sentencing. Now, we all know my friend General Petraeus has gotten a little wrist slap. He's been fined an appreciable amount of money, but it amounts to three-quarters of what he gets for an hour lecture, okay? Three-quarters of what he gets for an hour lecture, okay? Now, when the Justice Department, let me put it this way, when the real lawyers, and there are some real lawyers still in the Justice Department, saw what David Petraeus had done, given the most sensitive information, including the names of clandestine agents, clandestine case officers, including code word material to his mistress, and then lied to the FBI about it, they wanted to go after him. You know, it used to be, I don't know, did they change the law? It used to be a felony to lie to the FBI, especially when they told you that they were doing a criminal investigation. So what happened? Well, he got off, right? Now, the supreme indignity, which you probably don't know about, is that we were at the trial, a lot of us, in January. We saw what happened. February was clear, he's going to be sentenced. Going to be sentenced on April the 24th. Okay, well, on April the 16th, we got word, no, it's not going to be on the 24th. It will be later, May 11th. And we said, well, why? You know, this is plans. And, well, it turned out that General Petraeus was going to be sentenced on April 23rd. You know, there's not much embarrassment left in our government, but even our government felt that could be a little embarrassing for General Petraeus to be let off with a wrist slap and Jeffrey Sterling to be sentenced to whatever he'd be going to be sentenced about. Now, his lawyers are working on that, but that's the kind of establishment we have in this country. You call it democracy, it's not very constitutional, and in this case, equal justice, forget about it. Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Our next speaker, Jesslyn Radek, is a director of National Security and Human Rights Program at the Government Accountability Project, also known as GAP. As an attorney, she's represented many whistleblowers, and I'll mention just a few of them. Edward Snowden, Thomas Drake, and John Kerouac. She's a former trial attorney and legal ethics advisor at the U.S. Department of Justice. So, Jesslyn Radek.
I'm also a whistleblower myself, which led me to this career choice of representing whistleblowers, which for me, used to mean representing people who had blown the whistle on fraud, waste, abuse, or other illegality, and had suffered workplace retaliation, including demotions, transfers to meaningless positions, maybe losing their security clearance, or at worst, being fired. So I knew in the case of Tom Drake, when a whistleblower who had gone through every conceivable internal channel to his boss, to the Inspector General, to both houses of Congress, and instead of them redressing his problems, they sold him down the river to be prosecuted under the Espionage Act, the most serious charge that you can level against an American. Today, I'm supposed to talk about the landscape for whistleblowers and journalists. That landscape changed drastically in the last 4 days. We all owe a debt of gratitude to General David Petraeus for showing what a farce the war on whistleblowers and leaks more generally really is. I represent 7 people investigated, charged, or prosecuted under the draconian Espionage Act, including Tom Drake and Kirk Wiebe and Bill Binney. My clients have been blacklisted, broken, and bankrupted. One was in jail. Others whom I don't represent, like Chelsea Manning and Stephen Kim, are also in jail. Others, like Jeffrey Sterling, face decades in jail. And another is living in exile. The problem with the Espionage Act is that there is no public interest defense. It doesn't matter whether you disclosed information to our enemies for profit or whether you disclosed it to journalists to write about and to give back to the American people so they know what's being done in their name with their taxpayer dollars. Espionage Act prosecutions occur largely in secret and have been brutal. It's been used to go after whistleblowers and hacktivists and journalists. It's become the weapon of choice for the Obama administration, except in the case of General Petraeus, where he was allowed to reach a plea under an entirely different law to a minor misdemeanor and ended up being sentenced to 2 years probation and a fine. I actually think that that is a more appropriate result for people accused of unauthorized disclosures or leaks to the media. I think the Espionage Act has been a way to go after and silence whistleblowers, to go after journalists, and to effectively serve as an official secrets act, which our country has managed to live for more than 200 years without. In terms of internal processes for whistleblowers, they've been a disaster for all of my clients. They become a tool of entrapment at best. I hope that will change. I hope also that whistleblower protection will be extended to protect people in the national security and intelligence arenas who have made all of the bombshell disclosures about war crimes, about torture, about secret surveillance that you've heard about over the past decade. I would suggest that if President Obama really wanted to stop leaks, he would put an end to overclassification and he would enact meaningful and effective whistleblower protection reform and treat whistleblowers as a courageous and patriotic people he recognized that they were back when he was candidate Obama.
Our next speaker, Colleen Rowley, is an attorney and former FBI special agent as well as division counsel. She wrote a memo in May 2002 to the FBI director exposing some of the FBI's pre-9/11 failures. She was one of three whistleblowers named as Time Magazine's Persons of the Year in 2002. Colleen Rowley.
A few days ago, President Obama took responsibility and apologized for the drone bombings that killed Western aid workers. And in the course of that speech, he made a remarkable statement. One of the things that sets America apart from many other nations, one of the things that makes our country exceptional is our willingness to squarely confront our imperfections and learn from our mistakes. Now, I posted that on Facebook and I said, I wish that was true. That would be wonderful if we could learn from our mistakes. Obviously, we are human and we make mistakes. But actually, when I talked about the post 9/11, that was 8.5 months after 9/11, and all you were hearing was that there was not any information that could have prevented 9/11. And they were beginning to do these things, to go off the rails, depart from the rule of law. I didn't know, but they had already begun to order these torture and violating the Geneva Conventions. They had turned on the warrantless monitoring right after 9/11. I didn't know about that. I did know some other things, though. I had some clues that this was actually going to this dark side. And so I knew that the truth mattered. You know, 8.5 months later, if people weren't even willing to say what they knew about the clues and the so-called dots that they had before 9/11. So I wrote this letter, and I didn't leak it myself, but somehow it got to the press. And this was a moment of time before it was very early on, and they didn't know what to do with this whistleblowing. And on top of that, Time Magazine and many other press at the time recognized the importance of knowing the truth, the whistleblowing. It wasn't just 9/11, actually. It was Enron and WorldCom had collapsed. Lots of people had lost, you know, their life savings and everything. So there was this moment. It was a short moment, unfortunately, where unlike what Daniel Ellsberg mentioned about the press saying that their sources were snitches, it actually was a moment when people recognized that we need to know the truth. After my memo leaked to the press, within 1 week, I got asked to testify to the Senate Judiciary Committee. And the night before I testified to the Senate Judiciary Committee, I'd written up this statement, and I didn't share it with anybody in the FBI. I think that was pretty unprecedented, but the press office, nobody corrected me, nobody looked at my memo, but the director said, can I have a meeting with you? So Director Mueller had this meeting with me on this big table the night before I testified, and I was, you know, trying to, you know, he was trying to obviously say, don't say anything too terrible about the FBI. It wasn't really, he was only 1 week as a director, so it wasn't him anyways, and he told me, you know, I'm critical-minded too, and if you ever spot any of this information, intelligence, please let me know. Call me right away. And I took that seriously. And you know, if you think about intelligence, this idea of excessive secrecy, why are we failing over and over? You know, the drone intelligence is the recent one, but there's been many other cases, and people ask, why aren't they better intelligence? If you are suppressing the truth at the bottom and you say, we only know at the top how the policy is going to go, we make the policy, we make the decision, and now everybody get behind it, and then you come up with the intelligence that will justify our prior decision. Can you imagine a scientist who already knows how he knows how his experiment's going to come out? Okay, so it's really completely upside down. So if you want to do intelligence and you want to have really good security, you want to have the truth from the bottom. You want all the people that have the eyes to have the freedom to tell you, no, this isn't right, blah, blah, blah. And certainly you want people that if they spot something illegal. When I was the ethics advisor in our office, and I actually had to give a ethics presentation 1 week before 9/11, and I teach now ethics, so these slides are in my head. One said, do not puff, shade, skew, firm up, massage, or tailor statements of fact. Okay, so, you know, this is incredible that right after, I mean, a week later, I see this starting to begin. Everybody is tailoring and massaging, et cetera. And the other one was that we don't, you know, our loyalty, our highest loyalty is to the Constitution. This was impressed on all FBI agents from the start. And if you understand that your highest loyalty is to the rule of law itself, then you have to reveal illegality. How else can you correct it? How can you, quote unquote, fix the mistake if you don't reveal illegality? So the cover-ups are always far worse than the original mistakes. And we need, I'm just going to say, we need informants. And they weren't all snitches. Some were. Whitey Bulger. I mean, there were some really bad snitches that deserve that term. But there were other good informants and cooperating witnesses that came forward that told you how Enron had collapsed, that told you about a Ponzi scheme that you would never be able to figure out, or told you about organized crime, where everybody's benefiting and no one will tell you the truth. whistleblowers in the criminal justice system are recognized as the only way to solve a case. So it's really odd to turn this upside down, and I think we're doing this at our peril because our own intelligence and security is at risk without telling the truth and without fixing the mistakes. And it's the journalist's job to get the truth out.
Our last speaker before the Q&A is J.Kirk Wiebe. Kirk Wiebe is a retired National Security Agency whistleblower. He worked at the NSA for more than 32 years. During his tenure there, he received the Director of CIA's Meritorious Unit Award and the NSA's Meritorious Civilian Service Award, the second highest distinction at that agency, for the work that he did against foreign strategic weapons systems. Now, Kirk Wiebe.
Thank you and good morning. When Norm said we're going to have a press event, and I'd like each of you to talk for about 5 minutes, that intimidates me because it makes me think about what I'm going to say. So I like to be extemporaneous if I can be, but I'd like to put a theme to it, and that is I'd like to give you a sense of what it is to be a whistleblower. You know, you live in a small organization somewhere in a huge bureaucracy, in my case, NSA, and you hope you're doing good work. And I was able to do some of that with the help of my colleagues at NSA and excellent people employed by that agency in doing some very good work for this country. And I was proud to do it. But something changed with 9/11. You know what that is. And some upper management, seniors in government, thought we needed to go down another path. We needed to take a shortcut. Rather than do what the law requires, we decided we're just going to go out and collect all the information we can. As one of the Snowden ViewGraphs quotes, then Director General Alexander, having said, just collect it all. Did anybody see that? Right? On quoted. I think it was at GCHQ or the UK, some event, some briefing. I am now entering the phase where I'm becoming frightened. And I don't use that word very often. People have asked me, are frightened, yes. Are we going to get out of this mess? Are we going to be able to turn the Titanic? I really don't know anymore. I was speaking to a nephew of mine, a graduate of West Point back in the 80s. And we were kind of philosophizing and observing what's going on. And he said, Kirk, I don't see a way to prevent hitting that iceberg. I said, I don't either. Everything I look at, and I'm trying to read tectonic plates now. I'm not in the grasp of bits and bytes of NSA data collected by some system in Nova Scotia. I'm not worried about that. I'm worried about the fact that we have a nation who is now aware of this issue like never before. Thank goodness to these fine people. Thank goodness to Edward Snowden having leaked those documents. And you know, when I was first asked, is he a hero or is he a traitor? I think I took a breath before I answered. I'm going to tell you, I wouldn't hesitate for a fraction of a second to tell you he's a hero. Did anybody read the recent release by the New York Times of the redacted 5IG report that just came out? It's like, I don't know, 700 pages long. Did anybody go through it, just peruse it? I have not read it. It's too long. I've got too many other things to do. So I just flashed through a bunch of pages. You know what struck me? There were entire paragraphs and are in that report classified top secret special intelligence. Now that means it's electronic intelligence, SI. Special intelligence at the top secret level. Information that if it got in the wrong hands would cause this nation great damage if it were to get in the hands of the enemy. I noticed paragraphs with no redactions, except that the classification of that paragraph was literally lined out. A line, in other words, stricken, de facto declassifying it. I pose to you this question. If we have authorities in place who are not able to legitimately classify that kind of material, that critical to knowing whether we're doing the right thing or the wrong thing, the government puts those classifications on. They are reread and read at all the levels. The bureaucracy does multiple checks before it puts out a document. Someone came along, lined it out, said it's not classified. You and I can read it. How do you go from the most damaging to nothing in the stroke of a pen if you're even remotely doing your job correctly? Now, think a moment. Jeffrey Sterling and others have been prosecuted based on the release of what? Classified information. And the courts caved to the government's authority to do that. We are in trouble up to here. The court system, the executive, using authorities with the pen, the same that created NSA, overlooking legislative and the judiciary. We've thrown out the Constitution de facto. I dare you to prove to me that we haven't. You cannot do it. We are in trouble. So I wrote on this little piece of paper a list of things that say we are no longer afraid of the police state happening. It's here in small measures and increasing measures week by week, day by day, and it's not because there was an op-ed in the New York Times that told us. It wasn't because Jane Mayer or anyone else did a fabulous article in the New Yorker. You have to sift through a lot of little articles on page 17 of someone's media or minute 45 into an interview of someone. So it's time consuming. But when you begin to look at the things that have happened, and I'm just going to give you a short list of things that say we're already in a police state. What is a police state? A state that has an objective. A state that has the means to oppress the people being ruled. Certainly ours meets that. We have authorities. We have the military vested in the government. The government controls the means of reconnaissance, intelligence production. So we have the tools. The only thing missing is the will to misuse them. So let's look at some of the misuses of power. I would venture to say, and there's nothing political about this, both parties own this issue. The American society, I submit, owns this issue because we've become a corrupt society. We've become a society willing to look the other way in the face of wrongdoing. So let's begin with the IRS. Everybody's familiar with the IRS and people using their power against certain subgroups that have to pay taxes. Have you heard about the police raiding the homes in Wisconsin of innocent American families, roughing them up, intimidating them because they are of the wrong political belief? There's a lot of stories about that. How about the VA using private data of whistleblowers against them to make them look like idiots or incompetent? How about the FBI collaborating with the VA to keep veterans from buying guns because they are amongst the groups most likely to become terrorists? So says the DHS. How about DOJ wiretaps of Associated Press reporters? How about John Whitehead of Rutherford Institute, who just the other day said, in the early 80s, nationally, there were about 3,000 SWAT raids by SWAT teams per year in this country. That number now exceeds 80,000 a year. 80,000. Under the NDAA, the military can come to a person's door, arrest them without a warrant, without a hearing, and put them in a detention camp. Where did that come from? But it was passed by Congress. We now have tons of excess war equipment pulling into small little towns. We now have the police and Humvees and all armored personnel carriers with military type equipment. Why? How about parallel construction that undermines your rights under the Constitution to have a fair hearing in a court of law, where the government takes data from NSA, conjures up a case against you, and then makes it look like it came out of normal FBI investigative technique, covering up the source of the data? Your lawyer won't even know the source of that information. And now we have Hillary Clinton already talking about changing or getting rid of the First Amendment of the United States and making it a campaign issue. What? So I would say to you, consider where we are. You know, they say if you don't look back at where you've been, you don't know where you are. And if you don't know where you are, you don't know where in the hell you're going. And we just seem to be maxing out and making that a desirable process when we should be saying, wait a minute, time out. Let's hold some people accountable for what's wrong. And let's call a spade a spade. And I especially worry about you as journalists, about getting caught up in the minutia, not seeing the larger picture and where we're headed as a ship, as a nation, in terms of our rights under the Constitution. Thank you.
In our full session, we're going to have time for just a couple of questions, but then you're all welcome to interview individuals one-on-one here, either in the room or out in the hall or the lobby. And I know almost all the speakers will be able to stay afterwards and speak with you individually. Let me just for half a minute mention that while the individual voices of these and other whistleblowers is clearly so crucial to turning around these terrible problems that we face, organizing is also part of what's imperative. And Exposed Facts, almost a year old now, is committed to resisting the surveillance, the repression, the assaults on the First, Fourth, and Fifth Amendments that we've been discussing here today. And resistance to that assault from this administration and any other is crucial, not only as individuals, but through collective action, and Exposed Facts is part of that process. Are there any questions now? You can direct them, of course, to any individual speaker or to any who might want to respond. Yes.
Yeah, I'm Charlie Clark, the government executive. Are all of you in favor of the H.R. 1466 bill to repeal?
The Surveillance State Repeal Act. Yeah, anybody want to address the SSRA?
We all support it, especially like the idea of going into executive order 12333 and actually bringing that under control, too. In fact, I'd rather they cancel that one, too, because under Section 23C of that order, they're collecting all the content of data on U.S. citizens inside this country, of course, in violation of the Constitution, Fourth Amendment, First Amendment, and the Fifth, of course.
Something people have to recognize is there are these so-called, when we talked about this general national emergency that was announced in secret after 9/11, the laws, the Fourth Amendment including, all had exigent circumstances, so did FISA. So the idea that you're going to have this terrible situation occur, there are provisions in the law already for those things. The Supreme Court decided this. There's even something that you don't have to give Miranda rights if it's life and death. We didn't have to torture. I've been writing about this forever. I testified about it. So the law itself actually is a good thing. The pre-existing law exists for a reason. It was working really well. And there were these emergency exceptions already under the Constitution. You didn't need to declare a general you know, green light, go forward, and you violate the Constitution. You didn't have to do that.
Yes, so to reaffirm, the Surveillance State Repeal Act is supported by all the speakers today. Other questions? Yes.
What is the use of having whistleblowers when we have a controlled press that will censor out things like the collapse of Building 7 on 9/11?
Anybody want to take that maybe as a rhetorical question and other speakers? Yes.
Well, concerning World Trade Center 7, Carl Golovin, JFKVigil.com, retired customs agent. I was among many internal affairs agents who helped sift through the rubble of World Trade Center 7 at Fresh Kills Landfill, something that's a publicly available truth that simply is suppressed and not reported. But my question, or really a suggestion, is how to help all of you and all whistleblowers, how to get the public involved in doing what the Constitution says, peaceably assemble and petition. And I just want to share an idea and ask your perspective. The ideal focal point, 2 days a year, May 29th, the birth date of John Kennedy, whistleblower, who was killed for it.
To
meet on the public terraces of the Kennedy Center in support of all whistleblowers on those 2 days, honoring John Kennedy, who warned us about secrecy and tried to break up the CIA, for that matter.
Yeah, okay, so if I can extract from that question is, how could whistleblowers organize effectively around some of these issues, if I understood that correctly? Does anybody want to go into that? Okay, next question. Yes?
Debbie, you said there was enough information, and we believe there was enough information to prevent the 9/11 attacks. Do you think most of the information that could prevent the attacks was in the PDB from August the 7th?
What was that last part of the question?
If there was enough information to prevent the 9/11 attacks in the PDB from August the 7th?
It's more than that, I think. And again, there's about three or four things that have become publicly known. Not everything to this day is publicly known. This reason for the CIA not telling the FBI, there have been some anguished FBI agents who have finally spoken out all these years later, and no one has figured this out. This is still being kept secret. The FBI agent admitted he lied to the 9/11. So there are parts of this that are still being squashed and not talked about. The NSA's, as far as I know, the NSA's role has not been made public. So you know, there's a lot more. There were, at least to my knowledge, there were three or four major points. One are the two hijackers that came into California, but there were many more than this. And if you would have connected them, this requires sharing information. And so the 9/11 Commission rightly found it was a failure to share information. So what did they know? Talk about fixing mistakes. What do they do afterwards? Just the opposite. Now we're in this war on whistleblowers with insider threats. And the drone people will even tell you they can't share information effectively, even across whatever. So this is what's imperiling our future security.
I just want to comment here. The business about people not knowing that NSA had this information, that's not our fault. These three gentlemen from NSA and Ed Loomis wrote a comprehensive analysis of this, which we, veteran intelligence professionals for sanity, published on January 6th, 2014. We put it out in every way we possibly could. We got no resonance. Why is this meaningful? Because we addressed that memorandum to the president. I'm not the only one person here who wrote memoranda to the president. There are a couple others I can look at, all right? Now we know the format, and that's what we do. It's not a conceit. We do that so the president will be informed. So when we heard the president say, oh, if only we had a blanket surveillance program in being before 9/11, we might have been able to find out the number of those two hijackers in San Diego. Well, come on. You know about caller ID? We had the number. And it wasn't just one conversation of which the president spoke. There were six or seven, according to the director of National Counterintelligence System. We had the content of those conversations. Now, the fact that you guys don't know that, it's not our fault. We do everything we can to get this information out. But the president either was very ill-informed, all right, or he was speaking untruth. In Washington, we don't say he was lying, but to suggest, to suggest that if only we had a proven unworkable system that could have ferreted out at a number that we had. You know, you could talk to the experts here. We had the number, okay? We just didn't share it with anybody else. And if the president doesn't know that, then you get a little inkling as to who's running this country.
We have time for just one more question in this session, and then again, reminder, please feel free to interview people one-on-one afterwards. Yes?
Hi, I'm Mary Cerenzioni. I'm on assignment with Federal Times. Can I ask at least one or two of you to sort of reflect on the Whistleblower Protection Enhancement Act and sort of what that's meant going forward in the last couple of years?
Sure. The Whistleblower Protection Enhancement Act definitely is an improvement for most categories of whistleblowers, giving them access to courts that they did not have before, and giving them a number of rights. I mean, the original Whistleblower Protection Act sounded great on paper, but it had no enforcement mechanism, so it was a right without a remedy. The problem, though, that we still have in this country is that, for example, corporate whistleblowers are better protected than national security and intelligence whistleblowers who, despite a presidential policy directive, which, by the way, doesn't apply to contractors, people like Edward Snowden, wouldn't help him, has largely done everything it can to exclude national security and intelligence people from going to places of accountability, including agency requirements that they get approval from the Public Affairs Office before going to Congress, which is a right enshrined in the First Amendment. So you can quickly see how, you know, you can have legislation that looks good on paper, and indeed the Whistleblower Protection Enhancement Act definitely is a victory, but it doesn't solve the full problem.
I'd like to comment on that if I could. The long history, especially in the national security field, but even in the larger field, whistleblower protection has pretty much failed across the board. Basically, going to IGs, doing various things, they're supposedly within channels, as Secretary Kerry and former Secretary Clinton said, Edward Snowden could have done. As all these people can attest, simply exposes you to your agency for administrative punishment for being a bad troublemaker. It doesn't work. There is, however, a new, those administrative punishments, which include loss of access, loss of clearance, loss of job, loss of career, and usually loss of spouse as a result of this. I'm one of the lucky ones who didn't suffer. Actually, it's a common result. That's kept most people's mouths shut, no matter how many lives were at stake and how much the secrets needed to be out. But there's a new sanction now, basically, that's been threatened before but not actually applied. And that's the threat of prosecution under the Espionage Act, 18 U.S.C. 793 D&E. That was threatened in my day, but I was the first person ever actually prosecuted. And there were only two after that before Obama. Now with 10, people have to take very seriously that they also face prosecution, criminal prosecution, and long plea bargains and jail sentences for this. That could be changed, but only with congressional action, and that will take public pressure to do it. Just mentioned, but I don't know how many people recognize exactly what she was saying when she said we need a public interest defense, or sometimes called a public accountability defense. Yohai Benkler, professor at Harvard Law School, has proposed such a resolution, and that would allow someone accused of leaking classified information to argue in court in front of the jury and to present evidence and testimony on their motive and why they did it. I think very few people understand that that is not allowed and not possible under the Espionage Act. The Act was not written to allow that for spies, which is what the Act was written for. In other words, they didn't
bother to give spies a reason to argue why they gave information secretly to an enemy during wartime. It really wouldn't have done them a lot of good. But when the act begins to be used as an official secrets act against either leakers or whistleblowers, and I want to make that distinction, it's totally unfair, unjust, bad for our republic, and I would say unconstitutional, although the Supreme Court has never ruled on that. And the distinction I'm making is just this. 99% of leaks of classified information are not really done with what can be called a whistleblowing motive. They're mostly the way, the reason Petraeus did it, and has admitted doing it, to serve themselves for their biography, make themselves look good, or in some cases, make their opponents for the budget look bad, and to go against other people, for agency reasons, personal reasons, or to make the president look good. The Republicans, for example, charge that the leak of the Stuxnet, one of our very highest code word actions, you know, the cyber warfare that we were initiating against Iran, that that was leaked by the White House deliberately to make Obama look tough, and he was really doing something about Iran. I don't usually refer to high-level Republican people as my favorite source for the last word, but let me say, I find that pretty plausible, actually. And at least it explains why General Haas Cartwright, Obama's favorite general, who has pretty well been identified as the source of that leak, has not yet been prosecuted. My guess is that he's told the prosecutors, I was ordered to do this by the White House, I was allowed. I don't think General James E. Cartwright took it on himself to leak that super secret, except for the reasons that the Republicans claim, that it was actually in the interest of the administration. That's just a guess, but connect those dots and see where it goes. Now, that's leaking. That's not whistleblowing. That's not revealing wrongdoing, unless you happen to believe that cyber warfare as an initiation is problematic for the U.S. to start. That's an argument. But anyway, it wasn't done for whistleblowing reasons. The whistleblower who tries to reveal wrongdoing or problematic behavior, embarrassing, critical, the grist for investigative journalism, is less than 1% of these leaks. And that's embarrassing stuff to the administration because it's showing a mistake, a lie, an error, something like that. It's going to make the officials mad. And nowadays, under Obama, and he set the precedent, I'm sure, for his successors, it's subject to prosecution. So it's now criminal in the sense that you will get prosecuted for it. And you will not be able to answer the question in court to your lawyer, why did you do this? Now, I'm not saying you would always convince the jury if you told them why you do it. I'm not saying that all whistleblowing is going to look good to the public, to the jury. It may not be good. It looks good to the person doing it. But I think they should have the right to argue that in front of the jury and let the jury decide. When I was asked, as I said earlier, why did you give the Pentagon Papers 40 years ago? Objection. Irrelevant. That has been true in every trial so far. That's what Chelsea Manning found. That's what Tom Drake found. Everybody else, you can't answer that because it's irrelevant. It should be relevant. It can only happen if Congress rescinds paragraphs D and E, especially E for the unauthorized access to people, of the Espionage Act, which they should do, or amends the act to allow for a public interest defense, or acts a separate act, saying that people should have the same. That then would begin to protect not people, it wouldn't be an absolute protection against going to jail. It would mean, though, that you had the chance to argue in front of a jury that you had done this for the public. That way you would have not fewer whistleblowers, which is what Obama is seeking now, but more whistleblowers, which is what we need. Is investigative journalism doing just about as well as we need it to, doing a fine job? Intercept is an area, for example, that helps. You know, get stuff out that other people wouldn't do. Enough? If there had been enough, we wouldn't be in Iraq, and we wouldn't be facing new wars in Ukraine, Iran, Somalia, Yemen, a lot of other places. No, we don't have enough, and it's not good enough. Journalists should learn that they have an interest in the non-application of the Espionage Act as an official secrets act. We don't need an official secrets act like the British, which has no element of motive. Whatever reason you did it doesn't matter, just was it classified or not. We have a First Amendment, or we had one, until this precedent was set in this area. So journalists are not just self-serving, they're acting in response to their responsibilities to uphold the First Amendment, I believe, if they oppose these prosecutions.
I would also add to that that they...
Would you agree as a writer?
I agree completely that the Espionage Act should allow a public interest defense and your motive should matter, and it does not. But I also wanted to mention there are some 24 other laws out there, including one governing the unauthorized disclosure of classified information and multiple administrative remedies that provide a whole panoply of going after so-called leakers. And I would echo Dan's distinction between people like Richard Armitage, who leak Valerie Plame's name for no public good or public interest reason, and actual whistleblowing, which is in the public interest and the public's right to know, to reveal fraud, waste, and illegality.
Look, I know I've gone on. I have to make one last point, and it's this. I don't think General Petraeus should go to prison. And he should not have been tried as the FBI wanted to be under 793. He couldn't have gotten a fair trial for all the reasons I'm doing under the Espionage Act. He was tried under something else, and got probation for it. There are good secrets, as we all know at this table, that deserve protection. And there are bad leaks, and there are even whistleblowers who shouldn't have done what they did. It's not that we're defending all that, but there shouldn't be secrets. But nobody but spies should be tried under the Espionage Act. It's very simple. And General Petraeus was tried, and one thing he wasn't tried for, lying to the FBI. I don't want to see him go to jail for leaking to his defense, actually, any more than these other things. It would be a very wonderful thing if finally one government official faced some jail time for lying to Congress or in a court or to the FBI. It would be a first. And for that, I'd be willing to see him go to jail.
And on that note, I think, unless this is...
I have to give a 60-second comment about classification. This non-disclosure agreement stuff, it only makes sense if you understand what governs classification in the first place, and that is Executive Order 13526. It's on the White House website. It's signed off by the president, and within it, it says classification may not ever be used to uncover truths or embarrassing kinds of situations. Never. It's a misapplication. So when you see lawyers holding up the NDA that so-and-so signed, what about the executive order governing all that that says you can't cover up truth if it's embarrassing?
And with that, I want to thank everybody for being here.
This is, because all this language is the